Innalhamdulillah Nahmaduhu wa nasta'inu wa na'udhu bihi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyiati a'malina man yahdihillahu fala mudilla lahu wa man yudlil fala hadiya lahu wa ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lahu wa ashhadu anna muhammadan 'abduhu wa rasuluhu arsalahu bil huda wa dinil haqq liyudhhirahu 'ala dini kullihi walau karihal kafirun a'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim bismillahir rahmanir rahim وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوعِ وَنَقْصٍ مِّنَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنفُسِ وَالثَّمَرَاتِ وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُم مُّصِيبَةٌ قَالُوا إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ وَبَعْدُ. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, the Almighty Allah Azza wa Jal, He has chosen us to be Muslims, and we are thankful to Him for that. And we ask Him to keep on guiding us onto the right path, and do not cause our hearts to go astray after He has guided us. And we ask Him to save us from the punishment of the grave and that of the hellfire. We are asking the Quran to be patient. We are asked to be forbearing, that situations will occur. We'll find ourselves in certain complex situations, certain adverse situations, and we need to be patient when those situations afflict us. And Allah Azza wa Jalla tells us in the Quran, وَلَنَّبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوعِ وَنَقْصٍ مِّنَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنفُسِ وَالثَّمَرَاتِ وَلَنَّبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوعِ وَنَقْصٍ مِّنَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنفُسِ وَالثَّمَرَاتِ. We will test you and afflict you with some sort of fear and hunger, some loss of family, some loss of wealth. And He tells us, وَبَشِّرْ الصَّابِرِينَ. But give good news, good tidings to the people who are patient. الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبًا. Those people, when some musiba means difficulty, adverse situation, some calamity befalls them, قَالُوا إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. They say, we belong to Allah, and to Allah is our return. So patience is a very important quality that a Muslim must have. And being forbearing, sometimes we have to take, you know, oppression, sometimes we have to take maybe beating, and sometimes we may even have to face death just because we have to be patient and standing up for what is the truth. So I want to share with you all a story in the Quran that occurred before the time of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, before the revelation of the Torah. And it's that story is in Surah Yasin, when Allah Azza wa Jal tells us, وَضْرِبْ لَهُمْ مَثَلًا أَصْحَابَ الْقَرْيَةِ. Give them the example of the people of a particular city. Some city there in the Middle East is called Antioch. إِذْ جَاءَهَا الْمُرْسَلُونَ. When messengers came to them, is arsalna ilayhi muthnayni fakazzabuhuma fa'azzazna bithalithin faqalu inna ilaykum mursalun. We sent to this city two messengers, but they belied them, they didn't believe in them. Now this city, the people there were pagans, they were worshipping idols, the idolaters. So when these messengers first come to them, two messengers came to them, they did not believe them. The messengers would have told them, La ilaha illallah. There is no one, nothing worthy of worship except Allah Azza wa Jal. As Allah Azza wa Jal tells us in the Quran, وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا أَنْ يَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ وَاجْتَنِبُ الطَّاغُوتِ. Indeed, we have sent to every nation a messenger commanding the people to worship Allah and stay away from the worship of false gods. So this message, these messengers came to them and told them, but they disbelieved them. So Allah Azza wa Jal says, فَعَزَّزْنَا بِثَالِثِ. We strengthen them with a third messenger. فَقَالُوا إِنَّا إِلَيْكُمْ مُرْسَلُونَ. And they said, we are messengers unto you. قَالُوا مَا أَنْتُمْ إِلَّا بَشَرٌ مِثْلُنَا. And the people replied, you are nothing except men just like us. وَمَا أَنْزَلَ الرَّحْمَنُ مِنْ شَيْءٍ أَنْتُمْ إِلَّا تَكْذِبُونَ. And Ar-Rahman, they call him Ar-Rahman, have not revealed anything. You are lying. You are nothing but liars. You are nothing but lying. Now, Something like this, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, when he came to the people of Makkah, they want to know why it is that this messenger come from among man. Why it is an angel didn't come with treasures? He has a special garden. Why it is a man has to come as a messenger? Well, one of the very simple answers is that if an angel had come with a message, man would have said, well, we are human beings, we can't follow angels. The angels have more power than we have. We can't follow their steps. So Allah Azza wa Jal, in His wisdom, He sent a man. All His messengers were men. So that people could say, oh, these are men, they can be followed. We may not reach the piety, and we cannot reach the piety of these men, but they can be followed because they are men. Right? They said about the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, مَا لِهَذَا الرَّسُولِ يَأْكُلُ طُعَامُ وَيَمْشِي فِي الْأَسْوَاقِ. They say, what's the matter with this messenger? He has to eat food. If he's coming from Allah, he shouldn't need food. He has to eat food, and he has to go into the marketplace to do trade and to buy and sell. He shouldn't need that if he's a messenger of Allah Azza wa Jal. So Allah Azza wa Jal made the messengers in such a way that man can follow them. Right? The Quran tells us, قُلْ إِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشْرٌ مِثْلُكُمْ. Say, O Muhammad, I am a man just like you. And in one hadith, he gets up and he rests. He's married to the woman. He eats, and sometimes he doesn't eat, and he would fast, and different things like that he would do. So he said, "Qul innama ana basharun mithlukum yuha ilayya." This is the difference. It has been revealed to me, yuha ilayya annama ilahukum ilahu wahid, that your Lord, your God is only one God. So this is the difference with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the rest of us. He got revelation from Allah Azza wa Jal. But the rest of him, he has to eat, he has to sleep. He gets married to the woman, he has his desires. Right? And he challenges in a halal way. And all the other things as well. He's a man just like us, except for that revelation. So man can follow the prophets because they were men. And they can be followed. And we strive for excellence within ourselves. And we know that we cannot reach the level of the Anbiya, of the prophets. We know that for a fact. So it goes on again. So these people say, "Qalu rabbuna ya'lamu inna ilaykum la mursalun." They emphasize now that our Lord know that indeed we are messengers sent to you to command you not to worship idols, but to worship the Almighty Allah Azza wa Jalla alone. Wa ma alayna illa al-balaghul mubin. And this is a very important qa'ida. This is a very important principle when you're given da'wah. And we have to understand it, even concerning our families. وَمَا عَلَيْنَا إِلَّا الْبَلَاغُ الْمُبِينَ. They told the people, there is nothing compulsory upon us except to give the clear message that was revealed to them by their Lord. And we, as Muslims, when we are given da'wah, we must understand that we are not guides. We are not the ones who will guide people. Allah Azza wa Jal is the one who will guide. We can just show them this is correct and this is wrong. All we have to do is give the clear message and give it in a nice way. And sometimes we may have family who are Muslims but they're not doing what they're supposed to do. Or we may have families who are not Muslims. Right? You must remember this in your minds and try not to get too frustrated and depressed. وَمَا عَلَيْنَا إِلَّا الْبَلَاغُ الْمُبِينَ. There's nothing on us except to give the clear message. Who want to believe, let them believe. Who want to disobey and disbelieve, it's between themselves and Allah Azza wa Jal. So this is what the messengers told them. وَمَا عَلَيْنَا إِلَّا الْبَلَاغُ الْمُبِينَ. In other words, we have to give the message. If we do not give the message, our Lord will take us to task. And He knows that we are not lying to you. And if it is we are lying to you, He will be the first one to take revenge upon us. And He will punish us. قَالُوا إِنَّا تَطَيَّرْنَا بِكُمْ. So they're trying different things. And the people now are saying that, when we look at you, we feel an evil omen. We are getting an evil sign when we look at you. And now this is a part of superstition and it's haram in Islam. It's to do with shirk. So if it is, like for instance, a vulture or a cobra come and land on somebody's house, that's a bad omen. But if a hummingbird come and land on your house, that's a good omen, that's a good sign. This is not in Islam. This is haram in Islam. So they're saying that, you know, you people are coming and we are getting a bad feeling about you. La illam tantahu, and now the threat comes. So the dawah has been given every day. They're talking. Right? Now the threat comes because these messengers are not budging and they're only three against the whole city. La illam tantahu, if you do not stop. Lam narujumannakum, we will stone you. Right? Wala yamassannakum minna adhabun aleem, and a grievous punishment will touch you from us. They use the word touch you. They threaten to kill them if they don't stop. If you're going to be a Muslim, people may do this. If you give in the da'wah, this is what people want to do. And there may be even sectarian violence in Islam where people are coming out and speaking against the Shia, speaking against the Qadiani, speaking against this one and that one. And these people can threaten them. It happens all over the place. They can threaten them. The other way happens too, which is wrong. The Muslims, the Sunni Muslims go on burning mosques and killing people like this. You know, you have to be very, very careful of that. So the messenger, they answered, "Qul ta'irukum ma'akum." He said, "Your evil sign will return upon you. Your evil signs that you're seeing on us is going to return upon you. And in dhukirtum, is it because you're only saying this because you have been warned and you have been asked to remember the Almighty Allah Azza wa Jal? Bal antum qawmu musrifun. Rather, you are people who have gone astray. You are people who have overdone it. You've gone beyond the boundary." And then, وَجَاءَ مِنْ أَقْصَى الْمَدِينَةِ رَجُلُ يَسْعَى قَالَ يَا قَوْمِ اتَّبِعُوا الْمُرْسَلِينَ. And then from the lowest part, the furthest part of the city, came a man running to them. He said, "يَا قَوْمِ اتَّبِعُوا الْمُرْسَلِينَ, follow the messengers. اتَّبِعُوا مَنْ لَا يَسْأَلُكُمْ أَجْرًا وَهُمْ مُهْتَدُونَ, follow those people who are not asking for any rewards and they are guided. You know, we have some religions in Trinidad and Tobago, the preachers and so of these religions, they collect money from the congregation compulsory. If you want them to preach, you have to pay them. Okay, and every week they collect a whole lot of money. There was a whole sort of scandal that went on in the 80s and all that concerning something like this. But they collect money. In Islam, people can pay us to preach. You have organizations can pay you to preach, pay you to be an imam. I pay you to come and give a lecture, but that must not be your objective. There is ordinary dawah that we have to give. We have to give dawah. We have to tell the people what is right from what is wrong. So if it is that I want to tell the people of Trinidad and Tobago, right, about tawheed and things, I will tell the people of Trinidad and Tobago, give me some money and I'll tell you the truth. No, it's not like that. You have to speak the truth and you have to give dawah. So I will tell people, you know, you see, the priests and the what, not from the different other denominations of a religion, they're very rich. Right? You see a lot of imams and them, and you see a lot of them are very poor. Why? Because we can't demand this. Imams can't go and say, "You have to give me 10% of your salary." They can't do that. The da'wah has to come from your heart, and you have to give that da'wah. You have to give that message. So the followers, this man, and his name was Habib. Habib is telling his people, follow those people who are not asking you for any money. They're not asking you for any rewards. They don't want anything from you except to worship Allah Azza wa Jal. They are messengers, and they are guided. And he went on. He says, وَمَا لِيَ لَا عَبُدُ الَّذِي فَطَرَنِي وَإِلَيْهِ تُرْجَعُونَ. You know, why it is I cannot worship the one who created me, and eventually you all will return to him. There's a lot of story here. You are going to return to the one who has created you. Why don't you want to worship him? He went on and saying, should I take idols other than the one who has created me, that if Allah Azza wa Jal wants to harm me, they will not be able to help me at all? If Allah wants to harm me, these idols that you want me to worship cannot benefit me in no way. Okay? Then I would be in very clear error, right? And then he says very clearly, I believe in your God, in your Lord. So listen to me. he's making a very clear statement. I believe in your Lord, fasma'un. So listen to me. Now this is trouble. The people threaten to kill the messengers. This man is siding with them. What do you think is going to happen? He's going to be part of whatever they're going to meet out to the messengers. He is going to get it as well. But what happened was that, now remember, the messengers know. The messengers know that Allah Azza wa Jalla is protecting them, that they have to do it. This man is an ordinary man. He believes Allah will protect him, but he's not getting revelation from Allah Azza wa Jalla. So he's very brave. And he was a person who, when he worked, he used to give half of his money in charity. And also he was afflicted by leprosy. Right? So there you have it, a man very charitable, very kind, hardworking. They say he was a carpenter, some say he was a bleacher, some say he used to make ropes and all these things. Whatever it was, hardworking and giving his money in charity and supporting the messengers when they came in Tawheed. And then what happened? The Quran says, قِيلَ ادْخُلُ الْجَنَّةِ. The Quran says, it was said to him, enter Jannah. So there was a little gap there. When he said that he believed in Allah Azza wa Jal, the people got angry with him and they stomped on him until he died. They killed him. All their anger came out on him. And it was very graphic, the tafsir of it, what happened to him. They said they pelted him and then they stomped on him until his collarbone came out, the anus. You know, he was stomped really, really terribly. And then when he died as a martyr. And then Allah told him, قِيلَ ادْخُلِ الْجَنَّةِ, enter into Jannah. And when, now this is before Judgment Day. There are people, Allah Azza wa Jalla is going to have them going to certain places in Jannah before judgment. This is the life of the grave. And there are people in the grave who are going to be punished from the fire of hell. So this man died as a martyr, قِيلَ ادْخُلِ الْجَنَّةِ. And the thing he's worried about, قَالَ يَا لَيْتَ قَوْمِ يَعْلَمُونَ بِمَا غَفَرَ لِي رَبِّي وَجَعَلَنِي مِنَ الْمُكْرَمِينَ. He's still worrying about his people. He said, يَا لَيْتَ قَوْمِ يَعْلَمُونَ. He said, oh, if my people could only know of how Allah Azza wa Jal has forgiven me and he has honored me. Why? He wants his people to worship Allah Azza wa Jal. It was also mentioned he asked Allah to forgive his people because they didn't know what they were doing when they were killing him. Allah Azza wa Jal, eventually Allah Azza wa Jal sent Angel Jibreel, and Angel Jibreel took the as I mentioned in the tafsir, he held onto the gates of the city, and he gave one shout, and they all were wiped out. The people of that city, they all got wiped out. Allah Azza wa Jal destroyed them. Destroyed them because they killed one of Allah's Wali Allah, Habib. One servant of Allah Azza wa Jal that Allah loved. And they denied the messengers. So Allah Azza wa Jal destroyed them. So this is it, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam. We say we are Muslims and we have to stand up for what is right. You don't have to go about the place making trouble. Habib al-Najjar didn't make any trouble. He said, this is what it is. He didn't threaten to fight them. He didn't threaten with anything. He didn't have any explosive around him to blow them up or anything like that. He said, follow the messengers. I believe in them. If I don't believe in Allah Azza wa Jal, then why? What am I doing? These gods can't help me. And because of making those statements, they killed him. So we are Muslims and we will have to make statements as well. And when we make those statements, we do not know what test Allah Azza wa Jal is going to place us under. But we have to be patient and forbearing in all that happens. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ وَلِسَائِرِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ مِنْ كُلِّ ذَنْبٍ فَاسْتَغْفِرُهُ إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ.
طلع البدر علينا من ثم ثنيات الوداع وجبال